It's a crisis, a problem that plagues our generation.
Has become an object of fixation and is every girl's and guy's frustration.
Who am I? What is my identity? See, we try to find it in different places because our heart is filled with empty spaces.
We try to find it in our relationships with our friends, or maybe romantic things that we swear won't ever end,
or maybe with our success and doing well in school, or wearing the right clothes and trying to be cool,
or playing sports and being the best jock, or trying to be the creative one in the flock.
Girls striving for a size 2 instead of realizing what God sees in you. See, all those things won't fill that hole. Instead, those worldly things will take their toll.
The world's identity leaves you striving for something unreal, and you become stuck in this impossible ideal.
But listen, here's what's real.
All the things the world says you are unreal, a facade.
Genesis 1:27 tells us that we are made in His image, the image of God.
Yes, God, our provider and friend, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who formed us out of dust and sand
and sits there with the whole world in the palm of His hand,
tells you who you are.
God says you are the salt of the earth.
God says He has known your plans before your very birth.
God says you are seated on the right side with Christ.
God says you are worth His Son paying the ultimate price.
God says you are workmanship, His beautiful creation. God says you have the power to be a force for Him, to change nations.
God says you are nothing without Him.
God says we are the light in a world so dim.
God says He is limitless and we have access to that power. God says you are my child, my chosen one.
You are precious to both me and my son. See, God has told you your identity. It's right in front of your face.
Stop settling for the world's definition in its place.
I know who I am.
I know who I am.
I know who I am. I am who God says I am.
Well, joining us now to talk about the issue of who am I is speaker and author Rachel Lovingood. Rachel, welcome to the program.
Well, thanks.
Boy, I have often said, I have 4 daughters. I'm so thankful I'm not growing up in the world today. I think it's very difficult. Why do you think women struggle so much with identity crisis?
So much of it is what you just said. The world has changed so much, and we're just constantly bombarded with these media messages that tell us that we're not good enough, we're not pretty enough, we're not small enough, we're not tall enough, we're not enough. And it just kind of feeds into that whole compulsion we have to race around looking for meaning and, you know, try anything to get that, which of course we know as believers that we'll never find true meaning apart from Christ, but that's what happens, you know, and people just try everything.
Well, and before you know the truth about that, you buy the lie. It's so easy. It seems. I mean, when you look at it, life circumstance happens. If you don't know God, if you don't understand His plan and His purpose for you, you're kind of a pawn in the game.
Exactly. And you know, the enemy is the father of lies. And of course, we know that he's out there orchestrating all of that so much. And we buy into it because it's, have you noticed how much easier it is to believe the lies than it is to believe the truth?
Why is that?
I don't know, but maybe it goes back to what we heard earlier in Andrea's story about how, and what Gordon was talking about, how so many of the messages that are in our minds are negative. It's kind of an alarming statistic, 80%, you know, and boy, we need to learn 2 Corinthians 10:5, right? Take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ Jesus. But what we see too, Terry, is that it's not just non-believers who believe the lie, it's believers.
Yes.
I think part of that is because they don't know the truth.
Yeah.
They've not sat down and understood that powerful spoken word where she was naming all those things that God says about us. That's good stuff. I mean, that's things that we need to know and really believe it.
You know, you were married young.
Yes.
And then after you were married, your husband became a pastor. Wow, that's a role for a woman that can be very demanding. How did you handle that?
It's a little shocking. I was 20 years old when we got married. I mean, I know I don't look like it. I mean, I was a child bride, you know, been married for 27 years now. So, but 27 years ago, I was 20 and we got married and Jeff was already in seminary. You know, to be in the ministry.
Did you have any idea what you were walking into there?
No, and nobody told me. I mean, I'm glad I didn't know because I kind of got to figure it out. But, you know, when it kind of hits you after, you know, all of a sudden you're like on staff at a church and You know, it's kind of like, oh my goodness, we're like the leaders. Yeah. I was always looking around for the grown-ups, you
expectations.
Know.
Expectations.
Exactly, mm-hmm. and expectations. And so all of a sudden it hit me that I don't know what an ideal minister's wife is supposed to look like. So in my brain, I just went to the person I like the best in ministry and thought, I need to be just like Andrea Duncan, you know. Yeah. And then I just was overwhelmed because I'm nothing like her.
Yeah.
And just in those moments of kind of despair where you go, I'm not as perfect as her. And she does sign language and teaches piano and makes cookies. And I wasn't good at any of that except the cookies. And, you know, so I was kind of frantic. And it's like God just spoke a word in my head. And he just said, I didn't call you to be Andrea. I called you to be Rachel. And you're the one who's married to Jeff. And she isn't. And so you're not supposed to be her. You're just supposed to be the best you can be.
Yeah.
And that was just like the most freeing moment for me, mm-hmm. kind of to realize that God knew what he was doing and that he didn't create me to turn me into somebody else.
Yeah. You've written a book, Salvaging My Identity. It's been out for a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, in your own life, you wrote the book because you've walked this journey yourself, mm-hmm. but this is laid out so interestingly. And you said to me before we went on the air, it's not really a journal, it's mm-hmm. an experience. What do you mean by
right.
that?
Well, my friend Jennifer and I wrote that together, and the subtitle is a 40-day experience. And the reason why we did that is because we really, really believe Romans 12, 1 and 2. And verse 2 says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And even though we know that, you know, we sit there and go, I should believe what God's word says about me, but it's not enough to just kind of make a statement. Mm-hmm. Transformation happens by renewing our minds, and renewing our minds happens over time.
Yes.
So it's a process. And so we didn't want to just throw a book out there for you to read and just go, yeah, that's good. Mm-hmm. But what we want to do is give you an opportunity to walk through scripture day after day after day, because the process is all about renewing your mind through what God's word says about you.
You really have to slow it down, the whole life process
yes.
thing, and break it apart like you do in this book, mm-hmm. and then really take it for yourself. You talk about junk in
yes.
this book. Talk a little bit
we
about
do.
That.
It's a fun concept because we're kind of that trash to treasure, you know, uh-huh. DIY, HGTV fanatic things. But it's 40 days of junk. And the junk is that stuff that the enemy continues to feed us, mm-hmm. that he wants us to take on, that will mar our image,
yeah.
you know, and makes us look in the mirror and see a distorted view. So it's things like social media issues. That's huge.
Yeah.
I saw something on bullying this morning on your local news here. Worry, yeah. anxiety, fear, acceptance, peer pressure, all of those things are just junk that the enemy wants to use to keep us tripped up or to keep us in that bondage mm-hmm. of believing what the world says about us instead of what God says.
What do you want people to take away from when they read Salvaging My Identity?
A lot. But I guess if you had to sum it up, it would be we want them to see that God says all of these powerful, wonderful things about them. And when you really believe and are changed by the truth, that you'll know who you are. And 1 Peter 5, 8, 9 says that we have a real enemy who's roaming about looking whom he may devour. And it says, be serious, be alert. And I think so often we need to learn how to take our faith more seriously mm-hmm. and take ourselves a little less seriously.
Yeah.
And when we take our faith seriously, we recognize that Christian was never meant to be a label that we wear, but it's always been our lifestyle. It's always been supposed to be our lifestyle. And so if we'll be serious and be alert and stand firm against the enemy, then God can do miraculous, mm-hmm. exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever ask or imagine.
Well, I just want to say some of you who are with us today are probably relating to the story you saw before Rachel came on and the things that we've talked mm-hmm. about. If you'd like to learn more about Rachel's book, Salvaging My Identity, it is available nationwide wherever books are sold. And she's got a new one coming out called Even More.
Yes, ma'am.
Just around the corner. Keep your eye out for that. Thank you so much. What a good word.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. My pleasure.